Good afternoon, everybody. I am very happy to welcome you all to today's Curiosity During Quarantine, a lecture titled Metallurgical Heritage of India by Professor Sharada Srinivasan. As many regular audience would know, Curiosity During Quarantine is the online version of our popular monthly lecture series, Copy with Curiosity, organized by ICTS and hosted by Jawaharlal Nehru Planetarium. These lectures by eminent scientists are aimed to stimulate the curiosity of public about various aspects of science. ICTS is the interdisciplinary center which is involved in research, conducts programs where scientists of different disciplines participate to solve problems requiring specializations from different fields. And most importantly for us, science enthusiasts, it conducts several outreach activities. Curiosity During Quarantine is one such program. I sincerely hope that soon it will become possible to have physical, in-person, Copy with Curiosity lectures in the planetarium. Jawaharlal Nehru Planetarium is involved in popularization and non-formal science education. All our educational programs are being conducted online platforms. We had several batches of students attending our online summer programs. Our year-long program for school students, Science Over Weekend, has started. And soon we'll be starting reprogram for undergraduate students. Our popularization programs, which need public to visit planetarium, were suspended due to pandemic. Now, government has eased restrictions and has allowed many activities. We at Jawaharlal Nehru Planetarium restarted our shows from today. We welcome you all to visit planetarium to see our shows while following all the prescribed recommendations like wearing masks, etc. Coming back to today's lecture, I extend a hearty welcome to today's distinguished speaker, Professor Sharada Srinivasan, who will be speaking on an interesting topic of metallurgical heritage of India. I once again welcome all of you to today's lecture, and I request Professor Joseph Samuel to introduce the speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Galgali, and welcome to all of you who have come here. It's my pleasure to introduce Professor Sharada Srinivasan from the National Institute of Advanced Studies. Sharada is an archaeologist with an interest in ancient metallurgy. She has worked on ancient Indian steel, which was famous throughout the ancient world. She's also an exponent of Bharatanatyam dance. Her interests seemingly combine science and art seamlessly. Sharada started out by studying metallurgy at IIT Mumbai, where she acted in and co-directed a film which went on to win an award at Cannes. Over her rich and varied career, Sharada has comfortably straddled the two cultures of science and art. The dancing Nataraja bronze sculpture, which is on the poster of this talk, aptly captures her work and interests. Her work has been recognized in numerous ways. She was awarded the Padma Shri in 2019. She's a fellow of the Royal Asiatic Society of Great Britain and the World Academy of Art and Science. For her work of over three decades, Sharada was recently elected international honorary member to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. With these words, let me hand the stage over to Sharada, and we look forward to a very exciting talk. Thank you.
Hello, Dr. Samuel, Dr. Anupam Ghosh. Thank you so much for this very kind invitation on your behalf to give this talk on the metallurgical heritage of India. And my apologies for the delay due to some technical reasons. And thank you so much for your patience and interest. And again, congratulations to yourselves and the Nehru Planetarium for the very exciting work that you are doing in various ways. So today, of course, this topic of the metallurgical heritage is a very vast one, and I'm sure that it is not one that can be covered in such a short time. And even when you asked me, I had my concerns about how I could do justice to it. But I thought I would touch upon some of the highlights and also related to my researches in the area of archaeomaterials and metallurgical heritage and so on. And please do WhatsApp me if there's any problem, if you're not able to reach me, or the other number that we gave, that would also be fine. And let's hope we make good progress on this. What's happened? It's lost, is it? It's not moving. Yeah, this is all right, right? Yeah. So, of course, metals were used progressively in antiquity from those which could be more easily extracted and identified to those which are more complex ores, and then pyrometallurgical techniques were developed over time to extract those. And, of course, gold, due to its luster, was one of the metals that could be easily extracted, and because of its ductility as well, it could be manipulated quite easily. And in fact, gold is also found as nuggets in hard rock ore deposits and so on. And we have good evidence of early gold ornaments from the Indian subcontinent, from Harappan sites, such as Mohenjo-Daro, going back to about 3000 BCE. And these include sheet hammered artifacts and gold headbands made of repoussé and so on. And you also find these gold micro beads from the mature Harappan site of Mohenjo-Daro and so on. And since I was mentioning the gold headbands, I also pointed to this figure of the celebrated so-called priest king from Mohenjo-Daro, who also wears a gold headband. And that is one of the examples that you're looking at in the slide. And of course, gold, as I mentioned, it is also found in auriferous quartz veins. And there are, in fact, since we are doing this event out of Bangalore and Karnataka, where my host institution, NIAS, National Institute of Advanced Studies, is also based. Of course, I thought I should also mention that there are some very old hard rock workings for gold in the Hatti Maski region in Karnataka. And typically the mining for gold was done by following veins of auriferous quartz. And so these are some of these old workings in the Hatti Maski region. And some of them also have a carbon date of about 4th century BC, which fits with this sort of which fits the idea that this area was already known in the latter part of the first millennium BCE, since there's also a rock edict of Ashoka in the Maski region. And the region was also known as Suvarnagiri, or the Mountain of Gold, which might refer to the gold which are also obtained from some of these mines. And since we are in the Nilgiris, I should also mention that there are several old gold workings also right here in the Nilgiris. And well, what happens also with gold is that the auriferous quartz veins, which are at the top of the mountains where the nuggets of gold are to be found, when it rains heavily, these get washed down. And so it becomes minute grains that wash down with the alluvial streams. And in the lower courses of the alluvial streams, you can actually collect and pan the gold. And this panning for gold was still done in the Nilgiris by the local Kurumba children and so on, although these mines are quite uneconomical in many ways. And the way the panning is done is that they use these wooden pans and then collect the alluvial sands, and then the water washes on top of it and washes away the sand and so on, and the heavier gold settles to the bottom of the pan. And so this was how also gold was collected in various ways. And you're also looking here at some of the ornaments which are made of gold from the Nilgiri cairns. You're looking at this very beautiful ear ornament. And another technique which was also developed, of course, also quite widely in the Egyptian world and then spread to other parts of the world also, is the granulation technique, where these very small gold granules, which adhere due to the surface tension, were also used on the surface of the ornamentation. Although I did show you the earlier slide, which showed you that the technique of making beads out of gold using surface tension was already known also very early in the Indian subcontinent in the Harappan period. And more recently in the excavations, such as at Kiriri in Tamil Nadu of the 6th century, you also find these floral gold motifs, which also relate to the notion of there's a lot of description of flowers and such like in the Tamil Sangam poetry of the latter part of the first millennium BCE to the early centuries AD, such as the Kurunji and so on. The Kurunji is also one of the flowers which you find here in the Nilgiris and so on. So a lot of the year ornaments also have these floral patterns. And of course, the copper was also found in the native state and in the early, early Chalcolithic and so on horizons. It could have been also collected in the native state and used. But copper, of course, is very soft, and hence it is not a very hard metal. And that's why sometimes other elements were alloyed to it to make it harder. And typically tin was alloyed to copper to make it harder and so on. And of course, American Indians are also thought to have used native copper, because a large amount of that was also found and in the metallic state itself as unalloyed copper, and they used quite a lot of native copper as well. And by about 2500 BCE, as you see, the Bronze Age comes into vogue in the northwestern part of the Indian subcontinent, and this is the celebrated miniature dancing girl of Mohenjo-daro. And what is also interesting, of course, is that there are elements of the dancing girl which still recall to many of the local customs and practices of various communities. For instance, they wear these shell bangles amongst the Rabari communities in Dholavira, which is a site by the Ran of Kutch in Gujarat, where there is also a very old Harappan settlement site and so on, and citadel area that you're looking at. And you see these shell bangles also being depicted on this dancing girl. And the way the hair is worn to the side, that is still followed amongst many communities, such as the Gons and the Kota women, the kolkot that they wear, again, of the Nilgiris, where I am right now. And so as archaeometallurgists, we actually look at some of these specimens collected from these various sites which are excavated. I recall that I was told that this talk should be accessible to people from the age group of 8 to 60. So I hope it does, make itself accessible to a wider group. And so there is, of course, the use of copper bronze in the Harappan period. And you see here some mineralized copper debris from the southern reservoir, which has, as you can see from the analysis, which was done by spectrochemical techniques and so on. So that has about 80% of copper. And also please look at, note the color, because I'm just going to take you through the different alloys and the microstructures and how we identify different alloys and their use over time. The Mohenjo-daro dancing girl was, of course, made by a technique which is still used in the subcontinent and has been used very widely to make large castings and icons and so on. And that is the lost wax technique. So even that miniature bronze is made by this lost wax technique of image casting. And I'll explain in a bit how that was done. And of course, you're looking at the spectacular Chola Nataraja bronze from Tamil Nadu, the Hindu god Shiva as the Lord of Dance, which is now in the Chennai Museum and dated to about 1040 CE. And Ananda Kumaraswamy famously described the image as poetry and nonetheless science. And my analysis by spectrochemical methods showed that it had 8% tin and 8% lead. And so This image, of course, is made by this technique of image casting. And just to show you how that was done, I'm just pointing to some of the surviving traditions of icon making, such as in the Thanjavur district. And this is still followed in the Swamimalai regions and so on. And of course, there are also connections between the devotional poetry and the traditions of dance and music and so on. And you can see here also that the pose that is struck, the Bhujangatrasthakarna, is very much what you still see in the surviving Bharatanatyam dance traditions, which is drawn from Sadir and other temple dance traditions of the region. And so this is what we call as leaded bronze. And as I was mentioning, copper is not very castable. So the addition of some lead makes the copper more castable. And the tin also helps to contribute to a harder casting. I hope I'm still being heard and so on.
Yes, Professor. Absolutely.
Okay, yes. I'm just getting a little nervous every now and then, but do WhatsApp my colleague if there's any problem, yeah?
Sure.
So coming back to the traditions of bronze casting, so as I was mentioning that the image casting tradition has been followed over several centuries in this region of Swamimalai, and typically a model is first carved in wax of the icon to be made, and then it is covered by numerous layers of clay to form the mold or the investment. And then the mold is heated so that the wax is melted out. And in doing so, there is a hollow left inside the mold. And then the metal is melted and poured into this hollow inside this mold. And then the mold is broken open and you retrieve the casting. And you see here that a lot of final finishing and so on is also being done. And there's a very thick layer, which is where the mold impregnates a little bit into the metal casting, and that is called the fire skin. So that has to be polished and chiseled and removed. And there are also these runners that connect various parts of the body because, you know, metal is very viscous. It doesn't flow that easily. So these channels help the metal to flow in a bit better. And it's also very poetic that there is a verse by the Tamil poetess Andal, the mystic woman saint poet of the 9th century, who was a devotee of Shiva. And in the Nachiyar Tirumori, she likens the downpour of rain from clouds to the metaphor of the release of wax from the mold, which occurs in the process of the metal casting, and evokes Lord Krishna or as an avatar of Vishnu, as a skilled craftsperson. So there is this rather lovely interweaving of the poetry and the bhakti, devotional poetry, and the fervor of the craftspeople and their vision and so on in executing these masterpieces. And just to point to the other kinds of bronze casting techniques which have also been practiced, since we talked about the Mohenjo-daro dancing girl, this miniature bronze, if you see the way that it is also made, and also other aspects of the Indus Valley artifacts, you also tend to see that there are some correlations with other aspects of living traditions. For instance, the Indus seal famously has the depiction of a seated figure with a very prominent headdress. And this kind of headdress is still seen in contemporary bastar and so on. And there is also an execution of a contemporary bronze by the bastar communities, which shows this prominent headdress, which has the horns and such like. And the tradition of dokra kind of casting that they use, in this case, they make these very, very thin, slender strings of wax. And then the model is sort of built up with these very fine strings of wax. And you can see also that that is what has been done with the Mohenjo-daro dancing girl also on the arm, where she has these strings of wax added on. And here you're also seeing one of the wax models which has been made, which has this tripartite headgear that I was talking about. And there is a bastar artisan also shown here who's using this kind of contraption to make strings of the wax. In fact, that is something we also use quite a lot in cooking in South India, for instance, to make tengurel and so on, where the strings of this batter with rice and all that are sort of strung out and then made into murukku and various other things. So that was, I was also reminded of that. And of course, it's interesting that, of course, after the Harappan period, there is something of a decline in terms of the finds of copper, bronze, and so on, which is generally called a hiatus. But we are finding with more and more studies that it is not so much a hiatus, although, of course, we're not finding such an abundant quantity of repertoire, but still there are these finds which are coming up, which provide to some links of continuity and so on. There is this late Harappan elephant figurine from Daimabad. And now this, I should tell you, is also what we described as a solid casting, where the metal consists of, the object consists of solid metal, whereby first a model was carved of it, wax model, and then the investment was made so that when the wax was melted out, you get a solid metal object, in this case, a solid metal elephant. And that is described as late Harappan, about 1500 BCE. And recently, there have also been these very interesting finds of these swords from Sanauli and so on, which are described as copper Antinase swords, which also shows some continuity with other finds of the copper hordes and such like. And there is also a rather small but intriguing figurine from Adichinallur in Tamil Nadu of about 800 BCE. Which looks a lot like these Harappan mother goddess terracottas. And it is also labeled as a mother goddess figurine for that reason. And there are also these finds of animal finials, such as from Adichinallur and so on, again, dated to about 800 BCE. And another tiger figurine, which is rather interesting, from Kodumanal, which is dated to about 3rd century BCE, which is from the Megalithic period. And that also has these interesting inlays with lapis lazuli and carnelian and such like, though it's one of a kind. That also points to, you know, the significance of continuing with earlier archaeometallurgical work. And of course, the making of icons really takes off again following the Hellenistic influences coming with the incursions of Alexander into the northwestern part of the Indian subcontinent. And you see these motifs of the Buddha, which come into stone as well as in bronze. For instance, there is a gold reliquary, which is in a stupa from Bimaran in Afghanistan of about 1st century, which frames some images of the Buddha and so on, and also other Brahminical deities such as Indra and Brahma, along with the Bodhisattva. And you also see that it's a bit similar to this Gandharan schist of the 5th century. And so this kind of head depiction of the Buddha head also comes into vogue around this time in the 4th, 5th century. And the Sultan Ganj Buddha, of course, is the earliest metal copper alloy, which is known from the Indian subcontinent. And that is attributed to the late Gupta period from the eastern part of the subcontinent, somewhere in Bihar. And you can see that there are a lot of similarities again with the colossal Bamiyan Buddha, which was, of course, destroyed by the Taliban, which has a Kushan influence. And you can see the similar kinds of robes and so on. And this Sultan Ganj Buddha, of course, is made by what is called the hollow casting method. I was talking about the South Indian images being made of a solid casting technique, which actually goes back to what we were seeing in the late Harappan context as well, that elephant, where basically the entire image is made of solid wax before the wax is melted out. So you can see here that a radiograph has been done of a 7th century Pallava bronze, and that shows that it is a solid casting because a radiograph is totally dense. So that was really solid metal there. And this technique, of course, then continues on in southern India into the Chola period as well. And you're also looking at a Pallava Maitreya from the Government Museum of the 7th century, which, of course, has unfortunately gone missing. And it is also gilded, where it was covered by a layer of a mercury amalgam with gold. And then the mercury is burnished and sublimates, and the gold layer is left on. So that is what we called mercury gilding. But as you can see, that there was also a strand of the hollow casting, and the hollow casting actually comes in with the Hellenistic influence, really. And in southern India also, you have the Roman contact by about the first century. The Shatavahana rulers had trade with the Roman Empire as well. And also in the deep south, in the Sangam period, you have references to the Yavanas and so on in the Tamil Sangam literature. And you can see here some of these cross-fertilizations in the motifs. There is this lovely little gold signet ring from Karur, which has this Mithuna couple on it. And it is very much like the oval shapes of the normal gold signet rings of the Roman period. But the style and so on is very much as you see in the Amravati style, as you see in this little sculptural relief of the dream of Maya and so on. And here you can see very clearly what the hollow casting technique looks like in this Avalokiteshvara image, just a little on top from the Krishna Delta. And you see at the bottom of it, of course, it's rather damaged and it's hollow, and there's been something which is put inside to prop it up. So you can see that the other technique that was used was basically a clay core was shaped very roughly in the shape of the image. And then a thin layer of wax was applied on it. And then the whole mold was made and the wax melted out. So what happens with that is that you actually get the clay core remaining intact and a thin layer of metal on top. And the Greeks, of course, used this hollow casting technique a lot to perhaps to save on the metal usage and so on. And this hollow casting technique is also to be found here in this Avalokiteshvara, as you can see on top, which, of course, these kinds of images also get damaged a bit more because they are not of solid metal. And as I showed you before, the Sultan Ganj Buddha, the largest Indian corporeal image, is also a hollow cast image. Well, when we come to the technical examination of artifacts, you're looking here at a microstructure of a 13th century Chola bronze of about 200, the magnification is about 200x. And here you're seeing that this is an Asuka structure, because typically you see this dendritic structure. And the color also shows that it has got a lower amount of tin content. It is basically mainly a coppery alloy, and there's some lead added, which is in the intergranular regions. And some of the mining areas for copper are also to be found in places like Agnigundala in Andhra Pradesh. And here you're looking at this very spectacular old mine, which has a lot of the malachite stains from which the copper was retrieved, because that greenish malachite is actually the copper ore from which we retrieve the copper metal. So why I showed you this microstructure, do keep it in mind, is because, as I was mentioning, the Chola bronzes are mainly leaded bronzes or copper with some minor elements added as alloying as alloys. And basically, the tin content in these as-cast images, the Chola images, is less than about 15% tin. Because if you keep adding tin to bronze, it becomes very brittle. But it seems that they were deliberately using these leaded low tin bronzes for the as-cast bronzes. But they were well aware of other techniques of using bronze, at least at different periods in time. And one very interesting technique I'm going to talk about is of bronze with about 23% tin, which is described as a beta bronze. If you look at this phase diagram, a phase diagram typically shows you what happens when you keep adding different proportions of one alloying element to another at different temperatures. So here you're seeing what happens when you keep adding tin to copper and at different temperatures. So at about 23% tin, as you see, there is this Greek alphabet called beta, which forms between about 600 to 700 degrees centigrade. And it seems very consciously in the megalithic period, as I'll show you, there was the attempt to make bronzes of this composition, which empirically optimizes the presence of the beta phase. And I'll explain that in a bit as to why they were doing that. And another is the mirror making technique, which optimizes the presence of a delta phase of bronze, which forms at about 33% of tin. So there's also a connection between the properties of the artifacts and the choice of alloy to some extent. And this is just to tell you what would happen if you did add lead. You know, lead tends to also form as globules in the casting. And you needed lead to also make as-cast bronze less brittle and so on, because then the lead gets into all the intergranular spaces and it makes bronze less brittle in a way. So typically these are the way the bells were cast, and this was a foundry of one of the master craftsmen who is no more actually. And you see that first a mold is made of the clay, and then there's a wax layer which is added on top of the mold, and this is done using an axle and a sort of hand-turned lathe arrangement. And then that is smoothened with a spatula and so on. And then the mold is made covering it. And then again, the metal, the wax is melted out and the metal is poured in to get the shape of the bell. And this is what that microstructure looks like, which is a low leaded bronze. But this has, of course, tin of about a bit higher than what we saw in the other cases. It's probably more of about 15 to 17% tin or so, and some lead added. But I was talking about the 23% tin bronze composition, which is known as beta bronze because it approximates to the composition of the beta phase of tin and bronze, which has about 22.6% tin. And interestingly, you'll find that these vessels of 23% tin bronze, because between that 600 and 700 degree centigrade composition, the bronze also becomes very forgeable. It can be forged very heavily at that high composition, this specific composition of tin bronze, whereas otherwise bronze would not be forged quite so extensively. And here they were somehow empirically able to find that out. And so they've used bronze of this composition of 23% tin and extensively hot forged it in alternate cycles of forging and heating, or annealing as we call it, forging and annealing. And then it is quenched. And the quenching means that it is rapidly cooled in water. And what that does is that it actually retains this plastic beta phase. So in this particular microstructure at the bottom, you're actually seeing this needle-like martensitic beta phase, which has been quenched and retained. And once this is quenched, this kind of bronze has very special properties. It takes very good luster when it is polished. So you see that very lustrous property inside the bowl. And it is also very musical. So it goes also by the name of Talavattu and so on in South India, because it is musical. It's also used for musical instruments and such like. And this is also known as Kansa in some parts of Eastern India and so on, where it has survived as well. And you'll see that the outer part of the vessel that you're looking at, the shiny new one at one side, you'll see that the outer part is all blackened because that is left without polishing. It's the inner part which is polished. And that is also significant because when we look at the archaeological context, we do find, as I was mentioning, there is this very interesting vessel up there from Adichinallur, which is dated to about sometime the early first millennium BCE. And that again shows you how extensively it's been hot forged to this very thin rim thinness of about 0.2 millimeters or something. And the outer skin is also polished, as we were saying. And you're also looking here at some very interesting examples. There is this vessel, which is from the Kulu Valley in the Himachal Pradesh, where you can see it has these decorations, because then the decorated heightened bronze is also found from the Nilgiri Cairns, which is dated to the mid to late first millennium BCE, which again has 23% tin. And that particular decorated vessel from the Nilgiris that you can see, it also shows some evidence of lathe turning and shaping and so on. Although this is a very hard alloy, so they were able to manipulate it quite easily. And on the far side, of course, unfortunately, if we had a proper PowerPoint presentation, one would have a pointer and things. But anyway, the good thing about the recorded lectures is people can go back and look at it to try and make sense of what is being said. Oh, yes, that's good. Thank you. Yeah, so this was the, this was the Kulu Valley vase that I was talking about. And this is the Nilgiri heightened bronze. This has typical beta heightened bronze composition. And this is a vessel from Thailand, which is from a site called Khao Sam Kheo. And you see that, you can see that the outer skin has been left unpolished, and then the decoration has been done on it. And the decoration is a bit similar to what you find in the early historic context in India. And it is thought that this is likely an export to Thailand from the Indian subcontinent. And this is also, in fact, a recent example from Orissa, where the outer skin has been left, unquenched, blackened portion is here. I'm sorry, the whole thing is quenched, but the skin has been retained over here, the quenched skin. And here is where the polishing has been done, where the lighter bits are seen, the golden lustrous bits. As you could see here, the inner part was polished here in Kerala, and the outer has been left as it was. And this Kuli vase is also interesting, that it has a motif of a charioteer with four horses. And it also recollects a bit again to this kind of Hellenistic influence in the northwestern India. You have this Oxus horde with a gold chariot from Bactria of the mid first millennium BC and these four horses. So it's again brings to mind some of the interconnectivities of motifs. And I was talking about the Delta bronze alloy, which is used for mirrors. And as you can see, what happens when you keep adding tin to bronze, and this is bronze of about a composition of 33% tin, and it becomes very silvery white suddenly. And that is because of this composition of bronze at 32.6% tin. And it seems that for making these wonderful specular mirrors in this workshop in Kerala, in Aranmula, they were very cleverly optimizing the use of this Delta bronze. And you can see what a spectacular mirror image that is, a very, very high quality mirror image, because this Delta bronze alloy takes a very high polish, and the quality of the reflection is really very good. But as I was saying, that when you keep adding tin to bronze, it becomes more and more brittle. So this is a very brittle alloy, actually. So the whole purpose of the casting procedure was to cast a blank which could offset the brittleness and yet get this very high reflectance of the mirror. So to do that, they use a very skilled process. They devise what I describe as a crucible cum mold. You have here the two-piece mold, and this is the gap within which the alloy would have been cast. And then this is the investment of the mold. And here you have a cup. And inside this cup, the alloy to be cast, the 33% bronze alloy, is placed. And then the whole cup is sealed. And another very clever aspect of this is that by sealing this cup, this becomes a closed crucible process. You would have seen in the Swami Malay bronze casting that I was showing you, that was a open casting that you saw. Whereas here, this is a closed process where the mouth of the crucible has been sealed. So that what happens is that when this alloy which is placed here gets heated and then it is tipped over, there is no, there's very little chance of the oxidation losses, because when it interacts with air, then there is an oxidation losses and fire skin and so on gets formed. So this ensures a very good casting. And then that very thin blank, as you can see, has been retrieved and placed on this wooden polishing board. And it is polished very heavily to get the mirror finish. And this, of course, was to show you the hearth at which the late Janardhan Achari, who was no more one of the master crafts people, was working on making the Aranmula mirror. So the temperatures are reached through the hearth of about in the range of 600 to 800 degrees. And then you can see that this blank has been placed on that wooden mount, and then it is polished for several days like this. And then this very fine mirror quality is achieved. And you also have the famous sculpture of the Belur Madanika, who's holding something which reminds me of this wooden polishing board, whether she's actually holding something like that, and then a mirror placed on it. So it's quite interesting that one can try and look at some of these kinds of correlations as well. And of course, the motif of the Apsara or the Madanika or the Darpanika with the mirror is a very popular one which keeps occurring in Indian art. And here, as I was mentioning, of course, this is the family of late Dr. Janardhan Achari, and also with my husband Digvijay and daughter Lasya. And his daughter Sudhamal has taken on this tradition in carrying it further. And this is actually the largest mirror that they made. So this took quite a lot of polishing to do. And that composition of about 30% in a bronze mirror is also reported in a find from the Nilgiri cairns that I was talking about by Breeks. But of course, this was an analysis done many years ago. So it is coming a bit closer to this composition that we associate with the Aranmula mirror of 33% tin. So it suggests that there was, from quite early on, some kind of experimentation also with bronzes of different composition and trying to look at their properties and all that. Though, of course, we need to do more analyses. Now, I will now quickly try and take you through the ferrous metal aspect, and then perhaps just very briefly on the zinc metal, which is two other very important technologies that that were actually pioneered also in the Indian subcontinent and taken to great heights. Now, iron also occurs in the native state as meteoric iron. It does not occur in a native state at all on the planet Earth, but it does occur in the native state as in the meteors. And so some of the meteors, when they fell, that was then collected and exploited to make weapons and such like, such as by the North American Indians. But on Earth, of course, it is always in the ore form. And iron also has a very high melting point, and hence a melting point is about 1500 or so. So it is actually produced by reducing the iron ore to metal in the solid state to produce what is called bloomery iron. And this was taken and spread by, according to some versions, by the Hittites and so on. But still, there's a lot of work being done on the early iron and to look at that story a bit further. But coming to the Indian subcontinent, we also have the interesting accounts of Quintius Curtis, who wrote that during the campaign of Alexander in the Indus region, he was presented 100 talents of bright iron, of ferrum candidum, as he called it, by, I think, by the defeated king Porus and so on. So this is a rather charming illustration, which was in our book, India's Legendary Wood Steel, by Paul Fernandez. And of course, there's, I think, a lot more work to be done on the early iron, and I won't get into that too much, but I'll point to some highlights. Now, the forging of wrought iron, of course, had reached its zenith in India in the first millennium CE. And the largest forging is the famous Delhi iron pillar, which stands at about 7 meters tall. And of course, it has also been written about as the rustless wonder in terms of the corrosion resistance and so on. But the interesting aspect also is that this is one of the few dated metal artifacts that we have, well-dated artifacts, because this has a very nice inscription in Gupta Brahmi, which informs that it is a victory monument. And the name Chandra is mentioned there, and it is thought to associate with Vikramaditya Chandragupta II, around 400 CE. And that identification is also made because it also mentions that the lofty standard of the divine Vishnu was set up on the hill of Vishnupada, as the plaque of 1903 mentions. And it seems likely that this Vishnupada refers to the top of the Udaygiri mountain, which has these famous Gupta era cave shrines. And it's possible that the pillar was first on this hill and then moved to the current location, as other scholars like Balasubramanian have pointed out. And you can see here a Gupta era gold coin and this standard, which in some ways also brings to mind the notion of such a victory monument and so on. And of course, iron has a low carbon content of about less than about 0.04%. And that's what we describe as wrought iron. But now you're looking at the phase diagram, the iron carbon phase diagram, which shows you what happens when you keep adding carbon to iron and at different temperatures. And in fact, the addition of carbon, the more carbon that gets into the iron, it becomes harder and the properties increase. And to some extent, of course, this would have been discovered in antiquity, because when you heat the iron in a forge under reducing conditions, the properties improve because the carbon gets into it and it becomes more and more like steel. And of course, there are again a range of steels and so on. And in China, of course, the making of cast iron had been mastered, which has about 4% carbon in the iron. And that was a totally different tradition of using cast iron, which is, of course, a brittle element in some ways, but the Chinese had mastered that. But what the Indian subcontinent had really mastered was the making of a very high-grade steel. And this is typically described as woods, because it is the Europeanized version of the term ukku, which is the word for steel in South Indian languages, in Kannada, in Tamil, and Telugu as well. And this wood steel is what we call as ultra high carbon steel in modern terminology, which has about 1.5% carbon or so. And this kind of high carbon steel was not actually known much in Europe and so on. And it was very widely traded as well. The wood steel ingots were widely traded to West Asia to make the patterned Damascus blades and so on. And these fabled Damascus blades had these wavy patterns of the forged wood steel. And this basically, these patterns were obtained by forging the wood steel ingots and then etching them. And I'll explain a bit how that also emerges. But typically, this is what the wood steel ingot looked like. And these are some of the fragments of the crucible shards, which are also found at the sites. In this case, it is not, as I was saying, that when you try to carburize iron, what was being done in Europe and so on is that the wrought iron was carburized mainly in the solid state. But here, the mastery of doing something which is a crucible steel had been discovered, whereby you could take the wrought iron and pack it with a lot of carbonaceous materials and place it inside these crucibles and then heat it to very high reducing conditions so that the iron went into a sort of more viscous state. And as I see it, I think it was also more towards a molten state, so that a greater amount of carbon could get absorbed. And that's how you got a much harder and a better grade of steel, which was then used to forge into these Damascus blades and such like. And of course, we've written a book on this topic of the India's legendary wood steel. But so you're looking at one of the blacksmiths who's collected some of the broken shards of the crucibles and so on. And just to tell you what the composition of the wood steel looks like, so this is talking about the 1.5% carbon steel. So that still has the structure, this honeycomb structure of the prior austenite glanes, because it cooled down through this austenitic structure. And that honeycomb type structure of prior austenite is seen there. And then you see the perlite, the lamellar perlite. And here the cementite network has formed. So this is what we described as ultra high carbon steel. And this, of course, earlier I was showing you photomicrographs of the bronzes also to look at the different colors. But another technique for the analysis that we also use is called the scanning electron microscopy. And this is a scanning electron microscope of a Toddy Tapper's knife. And this was, of course, a study also done in collaboration with Dr. Jai Kishan of Telangana and Professor Ranganathan and other colleagues, and Dr. Jill Julef and others. And so you see here this structure of the lamellar perlite and the cementite. And that structure is also important when we try and understand how this pattern was achieved on the Damascus blades. Because it is when it has been forged, when you etch these swords, then the perlite, the dark perlite etches out with that dark color, but the cementite remains unetched. And that's how you get this alternating light and dark pattern. And this was known as the damask. So this is one of the swords of Tipu Sultan. And in this case, the sword also has this very fine hilt with the tiger motif and the Koftgari work, which is also done here very beautifully, where this is, of course, a different technique where the gold has been damascened onto an iron base of this hilt, and this is in the Clive Museum. But this has the blade of the Damascus steel forged from the wood singot that you saw, the alternating light and dark lines, and it also has the name of the blacksmith of Tipu's time, who was Asadullah. And it's also interesting that these sort of blades were also reputed to have been used in the Crusades. And there is also a fictionalized encounter which is described by Walter Scott, where the King Richard of England is said to have cut his bar of iron with his knife to show how good this was. And this was when the truce between King Richard and the Sultan Salahuddin of Egypt was taking place. And Sultan Salahuddin pulled out his Damascus blade, and he's said to have sliced a pillow with it because it's such a superior cutting edge. And this is described by Walter Scott as 10 millions of meandering lines. So you can see how that corresponds to the actual patterns of the Damascus blade. And the term Damask in Arabic also refers to these meandering lines. And some of my work had also been to identify the early production sites to try and establish the antiquity of the making of wood steel in the Indian subcontinent. And you're seeing here some of the crucibles found from a production site known as Melsirvallur. And when you look at the microstructure of that, you see here these globules which are kept trapped within the glassy matrix of the slag linings and so on along the crucibles. And this has a typical hyper-eutectoid steel structure that I was talking about. And you can see here this honeycomb network with the cementite and the perlite inside. It has clearly actually solidified from the molten state here, because that's why you see that it's a globule. So that also confirms this crucible carburization of the wood steel process. And it's interesting also that the term ukku also relates to the Tamil word urukku, which refers to melting. So there's also that kind of connection. And the term ukku was also related to yegu, which is a word for spear, which is also found in Tamil Sangam literature. And the skirmishes of the chieftains in the Tamil Sangam period is described by the famous poetess Avayar, which is dedicated to the chieftain Anchi and so on. And you do find these ferrous spears also from places like Adichinlur of the early first millennium BCE. Though of course, more studies have to be done. And I had actually identified some specimens of crucible fragments from the site of Kodamanal from the 3rd century BCE. Now, since we are talking to a scientific community here, I should also mention that the ultra-high carbon steel was then also patented in the 80s by a group from Stanford led by Oleg Sherby, who's no more. And interestingly, he found that the composition and structure of these ultra-high carbon steels was similar to the wood steel, and that these were found to exhibit the property of superplasticity, which means that they are highly formable at high temperatures. And that also explains why these blades could be forged so extensively to give those patterns and so on. And typically what you're seeing here in this structure is the what happens when you forge the superplastic ultra-high carbon steel. As you can see that there's this elongation and then eventual spheroidization of the cementite takes place. And here you're also seeing a microstructure of an iron nail from Pattinam, which is an early historic site in Kerala of about the first century. And again, here you see this hyper-eutectoid steel structure, which I was mentioning, the perlite surrounded by the cementite networks. And that also takes on significance because there are some accounts of the export of iron from the Seres, which could relate to perhaps a Chera kingdom, which covered also Karur in Tamil Nadu and also the southern parts of Kerala and so on. So there are these interesting connections that one can try and make between archaeology and the historical accounts and so on. And this, of course, is a view of some of the blacksmiths in Thiruvannamalai. And this shows, of course, what happens with the ultra-high carbon steel structures and the elongation and formation at high temperatures and so on. And that metallic structure that I showed you in Melsirvallur also corresponded to the ultra-high carbon steel. And it's interesting also that scientists such as Michael Faraday and so on put in a lot of effort to try and characterize the wood steel, and that paved the way for many of the findings that transformed into the Industrial Revolution and so on. And he also tried to, in his study quest for trying to actually identify what the properties of wood steel were, a lot of discoveries such as of alloy steels and so on were made. And it was only in 1825 that Mushet recognized that it was the carbon which was playing a role in converting iron to steel and so on. And he took out a patent, which was in a way probably inspired by what he saw in the Indian process. And the scientist, French scientist Briand in 1821, tried to do an astonishing 300 experiments to understand the composition of wood steel. And also, you know, with uranium and palladium, and perhaps in that process, a lot of the, other kinds of properties of metals and so on were also uncovered. And this is just to point out, there are other kinds of blades used as well. And this is a fascinating martial art from the Malabar of Kalaripayattu, which is practiced here by Kalari master. And of course, in the Kalaripayattu tradition, the women also were known to be quite very good practitioners of Kalari, such as Uniyarchi. And one of the very interesting blades they use here is called the Urumi, which is coiled, and then it is uncoiled and so on. It's quite deadly as they sort of swish it around and so on. And this is one of the very last few blacksmiths of Kollam who was doing some work on the Urumi. And the analysis that I did in the microstructure showed that it is had about 0.8% carbon. It is a kind of pearlitic steel, and it is what we call spring steel in modern times. So that also explains why it was coiled like that and uncoiled like that and so on. So that's also quite an interesting aspect that, you know, different kinds of ferrous alloys were being used perhaps for different properties and so on. And recently we also did a study on some of the metal cased rockets of the Tipu era, and these were found to be of a high quality mild steel. And this was a study that was also done in collaboration with Nitin Nolikara and Shijeshwar Nayak. And so we had looked at the rocket sample from SparkSource spectrometry and found that it had a fair degree of phosphorus, actually about 0.2% phosphorus and so on. So it is more like a phosphoric iron. And that's also interesting because the Delhi iron pillar, of course, it has much less traces of phosphorus, probably about 0.02% or so. But then that is also thought to contribute to the malleability and its corrosion resistance and so on. So this is a long tradition of using ferrous alloys in different ways. And of course, this is, as far as the carbon content is concerned, it's closer to mild steel, but it's quite amazing by how at that time they were already able to produce such a large number of these metal casings of very specified dimensions and so on. So, and then of course, these were also the precursors to the modern rocket technology, and they influenced William Congreve, who is credited with the modern invention of the rocket and such like. So that's another example of transfer of technology. I will make a few last comments about zinc metallurgy that have probably exceeded my time and so on, because the zinc tradition is also one that is a very important aspect of a pioneering metallurgical tradition in the Indian subcontinent. Now, zinc is also a very difficult element to isolate because of the fact that the temperature at which the zinc sublimates is, so that when the zinc ore is smelted, the zinc vapor immediately sublimates because its temperature of sublimation is also about the same as, it's about 1,000 degrees, so the melting point in the sublimation is around the same temperatures. And so it's very difficult to actually extract it in the vapor form because the minute you actually smelt it, as I said, it vaporizes. So what had actually been done in the Indian subcontinent, which and much earlier than it had been done elsewhere, was that a method of downward distillation had been discovered, whereby the zinc vapor could be so that when it sublimates, it goes through a condensation and cooling process so that it can be isolated in the molten form, whereas otherwise it would be lost in the vapor. So to do that, these specially designed retorts were used within which the zinc ore would be packed. And these kinds of distillation furnaces and so on are found in the Zawar region of Rajasthan, near which there are a lot of zinc mines which show evidence of working. And some of these retorts and furnaces have been dated at least to about the 12th century. And so here you have the furnace chamber, and which is fired from the top here, and the retorts inside which the zinc ore is placed. And then, so they had devised a kind of two-part chamber, and you had a perforated chamber here so that then the condenser, these long stems through which the vapor could go down and cool, and then the zinc metal could form here in terms of solidified droplets and so on. So this was a very unique method of downward distillation which had been discovered to isolate the zinc metal. And here you see some of these retorts and so on. And this is the perforated layer here of this the separation between the top chamber and upper chamber. And this is where it was fired. And here it would be drastically cooled by the because of the lower temperature and so on. And the metal would isolate here. So there's about a 500 degrees drop in a way. And interestingly, this is what actually the zinc ingot looked like. These are some coin ingots that I'd studied, and these are from the Deccan of about 4th century CE, some of the earliest examples of metallic zinc that we know. And it looks also like a droplet, and it has actually got a Brahmi inscription and so on. So, and these are some of the earliest examples of metallic zinc that we know of, though it's from the Deccan and is apparently not from Zawar, but it suggests that there were perhaps we need to look at some of the other sources and so on. And in fact, this, what is also interesting is that there are also a lot of textual descriptions which quite accurately describe the process of manufacture and so on. For instance, the Rasendra Chudamani of the Chalukyan king Someshwara of the 12th, 13th century mentions the musa, or the brinjal-shaped covering and so on, which should be used for the distillation of the zinc ore or karpar. And the Rasaratna Samuchaya also is a very major Sanskritic alchemic iatrochemical text and so on, which talks about the zinc distillation as Tiryak Patana Yantra and so on. So there's a lot of correlation there between the text and the practice and so on. And to me as a dancer, of course, it's quite interesting that the notion of rasa as a distilled essence is also something that you find in the Natya Shastra, the way of evoking a certain response from the aesthete, which is compared in a way to distilled essence, to a distilled experience and so on. And Nagarjuna, who's a 4th century alchemist also, and sometimes also linked to the Andhra region, but also elsewhere, he mentions the rasaka also, which may refer to the zinc ore or calamine. And this is just to show you that this is a 16th century image from of the Chera period here, which is of brass, and the microstructure of that, which we had done then in collaboration with BRC and CSVMS Museum, that is again shows brass, alpha brass in this case, and so on. But coming back to the metallic zinc, so there is, of course, not many finds of metallic zinc from antiquity, but it's very interesting that the Bidri ware is one of the early uses of metallic zinc. And in this case, it is, of course, an interesting example of a lot of cross-cultural influences again. And it is thought to originate in the Bidar region of Karnataka around the 14th century during the rule of the Muslim Bahamani sultans. And you see there that there's the influence of the Persian decorative techniques, because in this case, the metallic zinc is alloyed to copper. So it has about 90% zinc and the rest is copper. And then the surface is etched, and it is inlaid and etched and so on in ammonium nitrate salts and so on. And it's also a case where the etching also has a functional purpose, that it actually provides a very fine patination. because and then that patination is stable, so then it is less corrosive after that. So it has two purposes. It also looks aesthetic, but it also then makes it a less corrosive and interesting alloy. And it's also said that some of the etchings and all that were collected from the soils around the Bidar region. So I put this slide of the famous iron cannon in the Bidar fort. Since I was mentioning the forge welding, it was also used to make these very spectacular cannons by the forge welding process. And here is one of the craftspeople who is again putting the zinc alloy and doing some working and so on before the etching, because it's a grayish alloy before etching and then it turns into this dark color with the patination. And there are still a lot more studies to be done with that. Well, in fact, both the zinc smelting furnaces and so on at the Zawar region and the iron pillar have both been given a tag of the ASM International Landmark, that these are both very landmark technologies, both the zinc smelting technology pioneered in the Zawar area and also the iron pillar itself as an artifact. So these are both historical landmarks, and that's, I think, a great achievement also for India to have such listings, because other landmarks include the Eiffel Tower and the Iron Bridge. And I'll end with the slide because it also dedicates, and we were also involved at NIAS with this listing of ASM landmark to the iron pillar, along with some of our colleagues, Professor Rangnathan and Dr. Baldev Raj and so on. And here you can see that it also says, this plaque says, the rustless metallurgical marvel dedicated to ancient iron making traditions and blacksmiths of ancient India. And so in the end, it is also a testimony to, you know, centuries of hard labor by our metalworking communities and their dedication and so on. And here we're seen with one of the lady blacksmiths actually from the Tingaloo region in somewhere near Bangalore and her forge. And there's also a beautiful saying by Akka Mahadevi, the 12th century medieval poetess, who says, "Weld so that the weld may not be seen," writing in Kannada, of course. I'm now reading the translation of A.K. Ramanujan. And so what she's trying to say is that, of course, the process of welding should be so good that the weld shouldn't be seen, because only then you know that you've got a really good, an object with a very good property, because the better it is welded, the tougher it'll be, the more ductile and so on. But it also has a metaphorical significance, where it's also a case of whatever you do, that object has to transcend the act of manufacture. And I think that is a very apt tribute to the legacy of Indian craftspeople over so many generations, where so many of these bronzes and the artifacts and so on seem to transcend the milieu in which, you know, they seem to transcend the material and have a grandeur and eloquence all of their own. So thank you very much. And I'll stop my share. Or can we have the questions now?
Yes, yes. Professor Shadi, you can continue. I mean, keep it in sharing mode itself. Yeah.
Yes.
Professor, please go ahead. Yeah.
Right. So there are some questions in the both in the Zoom and in the YouTube chat. Yes. So we'll start with, can you hear me clearly?
Yes, yes, I can hear you fine.
Yeah. Questions from Zoom as well as the YouTube chat. So the team has collected them. The first one is from Siddhant Jakkar. Ma'am, in the initial part of your talk, you mentioned mature Harappan copper bronze repertoire. My question was, what does it mean by the word mature in this context?
Yeah, well, we use that term to kind of, because there is the what we call the early Harappan, and then, you know, going back to places like Mehrgarh, which is more the Neolithic and so on. And then that leads up to, you know, what we call the mature Harappan. So that's just a way of describing, let's say, the culture associated with the great cities like Mohenjo-daro, Harappa, and Dholavira at their height, because in the later Harappan describes, you know, the later context when there seems to be more of a decline of the material culture. And then you also have the earlier repertoire, which, you know, goes back to the Neolithic period from Mehrgarh and so on, which goes back to about 6000 BC or so. So I'm just using some of the terminology that it's been used by some. But of course, these terminologies change and so on, but it's more just to useful classification for what is worth at a particular point in time. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. So the next question is from Supurna Sinha. Yes. She asks, I've seen some fine gold work of the Muiscas similar to Bastar sculptures in the Gold Museum in Bogota. Could you comment on that?
Yes, the Muisca gold, of course, is very fascinating because they, you know, and they are associated with El Dorado and so on. And the Muisca artifacts, you know, even though gold has been used so much as an ornamentation across the world, for the Muisca, it was, you know, there as a ritual artifact. And I don't think they ever, you know, saw it as anything else other than ritual objects. But yes, talking about the techniques, because yes, it seems that the Muisca also used the wires of gold. But so they would have probably made these wires of gold because gold is very ductile and can be rolled into those kind of wires. But it's not similar in the sense that there is no casting involved over there. I think they would have just, you know, been using wires and then building it up. Yes. Yeah. But that's an interesting question. Thank you. But I think it does deserve more study and more comparisons in a way and so on.
Yeah. Yeah. The next question is from Anupam Ghosh. He asks, what is a radiograph? How is it done and how does it help to understand the object?
Yeah. So the radiograph, do you want to go back and see it or not necessarily? You've seen that. Yeah. Oops.
Yeah. Maybe you can go back.
Yeah. I'm not sure why this... something has popped up on my screen by mistake. Yeah. Well, actually, this in this case it's an X-ray radiograph, which is done exactly in the same way as you would for the human body or your lungs or whatever. The same technique, except that it has to have a very much more powerful X-ray and so on. And for instance, lead and other metal is very dense. So it doesn't allow, the X-rays through and so on. So that's why the hollow casting, you can see that it has actually, you can see the hollow areas there. Whereas I'll show it with this is a hollow casting here because it just has the clay core, right? So like the human body, the X-rays have been able to pass through. Whereas this one, since it had the bronze and it's solid metal, it hasn't been able to, you know, it has a dense kind of opaque look. Yeah, does that make it clear?
Yeah, I think there's one more question from Anupam. What were the material characterization techniques used back then?
What were the material characterization techniques used back then? Are you talking about what I'm using now to study or what were used then? It's an interesting point because a lot of this was done empirically, we believe, and it's a little more difficult there to figure it out because we, you know, you need to spend a lot of time with the craftspeople there, and many of them have passed on. You know, like the woods making tradition has practically died out. Even this was the last bell maker using the lost wax technique. Now they've moved to industrial production using sand casting and so on. So, but when I did talk to these, even this is a technique which is dying out, but talking of material characterization, of course they go by the proportions which they know. And the other thing is they sometimes do these sound tests. So they hammer it, the ingot and so on. And they see if, for instance, the quenched beta bronze, the idea of the quenching is that it then becomes, it is not as brittle or breakable. Whereas had it been not the right proportion or something, then and it was quenched, it would have broken. So they have these ways of testing. But again, you know, this has all been empirical and many of them have passed on. So there's not much way of finding out what sort of techniques they use for characterization and so on. And, you know, probably need more studies on texts and so on to understand these things. Yeah. But we do know, for instance, with the zinc, that there is some correlation there between, what they were trying to describe and so on. So perhaps more studies on textual aspects could, as well as discussions with the craftspeople, could help to resolve that. But in the modern context, of course, we have, I think as the more science and technology advances, the better we will understand archaeological materials as well, because, you know, in recent times, nanotechnology has become so big. And then when we look at some of the archaeological materials and we think, we find that there are aspects of it which can lend themselves to being described as nanomaterials. Even, for instance, the wood steel, you know, it's been said that some of these Damascus blades have very fine, you know, nanowires of perlite and cementite and so on, at least some studies suggesting all that. So there's a lot more to be studied there in terms of materials characterization, surely. Yeah.
Okay, the next question comes from someone, I think, who's a metallurgist. It's yes. with reference to the beta bronze bowl from Adi yeah. Chanur. Yes. If you could go back there.
Yeah.
He's asking,
yes.
is that porosity or inclusions there?
Oh, you're talking about the microstructure? Yeah. So, yes. sorry. Yeah. So in this microstructure, actually, this has a composition of about 23.9% tin. And here, what you're seeing is actually, this is the alpha plus beta phase. And what happens here is, if you look at that microstructure, I'll just take you back there. You see around 23% tin. If it is pure 23% tin, then you'll get the beta phase if it's quenched. And then again, it depends on the temperature. So if it's quenched a little over here, for example, then the alpha plus beta phase forms, which is the alpha solid solution, right?
Has it got cut off?
Yes, I think so.
I think she's gotten cut.
Yeah.
Cut off.
Maybe some.
The islands are of alpha plus beta. These and these islands are what have what we call as the annealing twins, which is from the hot forging. So it's a record of the hot forging and the quenching and the fact that, you know, the dendritic structure has been completely broken down of the alpha plus beta phase. That also suggests it's been very, very heavily hot forged and annealed and hot forged before quenching. Yeah. I think the metallurgist would understand more than the layperson might maybe, but
yeah. Scott goes on to ask one more question. I wonder if and how desulfurization was done back then.
If and how?
Desulfurization, how you take the sulfur out of the material, of the ore.
Okay. Yeah, well, yes, well, looking at this, you don't see much of the sulfide inclusions, as you say. Whether they were using, because again, it depends on whether they were using the primary ores were, copper oxides or malachite and so on, in which case you wouldn't have the inclusions. So what he's pointing to is the fact that if you have the use of copper extracted from sulfide, from, you know, copper sulfide and so on, or chalcopyrite and so on, then you would have some of the sulfide inclusions. But, you know, interestingly, I didn't put it in here, but I had a slide from some of the slags from a site called Ingeldal, which had some of the sulfide, but it seems to have been that they did manage to get quite a lot of it out because it was quite lean slag, really. A lot of the sulfide seems to have gone into the slag itself. So I think we need to understand that technology a bit better, but that was clearly using a sulfidic ore, but it seemed to have been a very lean slag, and you know the prills themselves were of quite high purity copper. So I think that is something we need to understand a bit better. Yes. And I have seen sulfide inclusions in other beta bronzes. So yes, I think it is an interesting question and the kind of thing that an archaeometallurgist we need to talk a bit more to discuss, to think about how that might have been achieved. Yeah.
Well, the next question is about the Ashoka pillar.
Yeah.
So the question is, what is it made of? Is it wrought iron?
Yes, it is wrought iron and it is made by, let me go back there. Was it further? Yeah, I forget where it was. It's further on. Yeah, it is what we call wrought iron. And so it would have been made by packing these iron blooms one on top of the other by a series of iron blooms by kind of, yeah, where was I? Yeah. So, you know, we think it's built by packing pancakes of iron blooms one on top of the other and so on. And but, you know, it is quite an interesting specimen because of the taper and so on. So how they achieved it is, you know, and whether they did kind of how they actually finished it to get that taper. Because I think initially they would have had to have packed the blooms one on top of the other. And some of the ultrasound tests which were done also suggested that it was a radial forging, that, you know, the cakes were packed like this and one on top of the other and then forged. Those, I think that was one of the scholars such as Anantharaman suggested that. Another scholar, Balasubramaniam, suggested it would have been put on a big axle, like you saw the use of the axle in another workshop, and then forged that way. So we don't actually, yeah, that's another aspect that needs a bit more of study to understand. But it is wrought iron, yes.
Yeah.
With the low carbon content, there's very negligible carbon in it.
Next question.
And that makes it more malleable, yes. Sure.
Next question is from Divakar. He's asking, what is the difference between the Delhi pillar and the Eiffel Tower? I suppose he means the Qutub Minar.
The Eiffel Tower?
Yes, yes. Yeah. I think you mentioned both in the same slide perhaps earlier.
No, well, I was saying that they've both been given the listing of the ASM landmarks, so that was the connection. Yeah, but of course, the Eiffel Tower, I think by that time they were using, you know, mild steels and stainless steels and so on. So it was probably more like mild steel, I would think, yeah.
Okay, next question is from Rukmini. Rukmini Day. She says, thanks for the wonderful talk. Could you please comment on the Qutub Minar? Perhaps you did, I missed it.
On the Qutub Minar itself?
Yes,
because this
on the Qutub Minar. The kind of metal used in the Qutub Minar.
The Qutub Minar, of course, is of stone. Was she talking of the Delhi iron pillar?
I think the pillar next to the Qutub Minar.
Yeah, I think there's an iron pillar next to it.
Yeah, so that's the one we're looking at. The Delhi iron pillar is the one which is next to the Qutub Minar. Oh, you mean she's talking about the location? Yeah, well, you see, I did suggest that it's been thought that this was not the original location of the Delhi iron pillar, that it was not originally in the Qutub Minar complex. It's thought to have been originally in the Udaygiri, in front of the Udaygiri cave. That is one interpretation. And it's probable that it was brought by Iltutmish and, you know, in the Sultanate period around 12th, 13th century and installed there in that particular archway and so on. So that is not the original location. That's right. Yeah.
Yeah, actually, Sukumar Sarkar is asking a question which I was also wondering about. The question is India still advancing today in tune with the same history, or Western countries have taken over India in this regard? In other words, how did we lose the edge that we had in metallurgy?
Yeah, well, you know, that's why I put in this slide here. When you think about it, you know, like, I think that although there was a lot of, you know, empirically we had maybe discovered wood steel or, you know, the zinc smelting and so on. But that aspect of experimentation that went on in that period in the, you know, 19th, 20th century, people, you know, the Western scientists were just experimenting copiously and also documenting. Like, even if you think of the phase diagram and how each phase diagram was built up, you know, it would have taken so many experiments of alloying something with something else to try and see what the behavior was and so on. So there was a lot of that kind of hands-on experimental work, which I think was what was going on in Western science or modern science and so on, which is what has got us where we are. So many more elements have been discovered. It's been exponential, you know, in the past 200 years, the kinds of numbers of elements which have been discovered, the kind of materials which have been synthesized and so on. It's not so where we lost the edge. It's a difficult question to answer, but this is what I mean. All we can say that this is what has happened in history. We can't maybe. It's too difficult to figure out how and why and so on, but that's where it is. Well, you know, even if you think about the fact that so much of machination, of course, although I would say, you know, for instance, with Zauer and so on, the zinc smelting was going on. Already in Europe, there's a lot of attempts, or even in China and so on, a lot of attempts to use a lot of machinery also to reduce the human, the labor aspect of it. You know, and certainly in Europe by that time with mining and so on. So that aspect of the machinery as well is something where there was a lot of effort in the European system, which has given rise to the Industrial Revolution.
So the next question is from RR. I think, can you comment on the different types of coatings used during ancient time for temples, walls, idols, and artillery? Kindly suggest references, if any.
Sorry, could you repeat that?
The kind of coatings used in ancient times for temples, walls, and idols and artillery.
Yeah, I don't think there's any one answer for all of that. Each of them needs to be studied and so on in you know, yeah. Isolation and so on. So coatings for...
I suppose protective coatings. I think that's what he means, must be.
You mean for conservation, is it? Because it's a very sweeping question. And if you're talking about conservation, then I think each material has to be studied in its own context. You know, there's no one. I mean, for instance, protective coatings for stone could be silanes, whereas protective coatings for metals could be, you know, other kinds of polymers and so on. So I think it depends on the material and so on. It's not a sweeping question. And I think one lecture can only cover so many things because, you know, we have to leave something for researchers to study and figure out for themselves as well.
Yeah, I think we can wind up now. So let me just thank Sharda for a very wonderful talk, and it's raised a lot of discussion. And, you know, I think most of us didn't know that there was so much expertise in this area of metallurgy. So let's all thank Sharda for putting aside her busy schedule to educate us about this matter.
Thank you so much, Joseph. That was a wonderful opportunity, and I'm really sorry for all the glitches and so on. And shall I put on my video so people could just get a glimpse of me now that we've not got the problem of, So thank you so much for all the patient and it is great encouragement because these are still very niche areas. And although here it looks like a lot of ground can be covered very easily, actually it is a very difficult subject because the archaeology is difficult, actually going and finding artifacts and, you know, going to mining sites or even, you know, the archaeological work itself. And then getting the access to laboratories and so on is also very difficult because, you know, these are not such well-funded subjects. All of this takes a lot of effort. So I also feel that there are no pat answers because, you know, you need to do, I mean, as scientists, you need to really study things quite thoroughly before you come to observations and so on. And I think we need to impose that rigor also in these kinds of subjects to take it to kind of international levels. But I think it's wonderful to have all this interest and, you know, I hope it results in a lot more of engagement and stimulation with these fascinating aspects of artifacts around the world, apart from India. And it's been a wonderful set of questions and discussions. Thank you all very much. And thank you, Dr. Joseph and Dr. Ghosh, for this opportunity as well. Thank you.
Yeah. So I think this one, the Scott Mutu just wants to thank you. He says, an outstanding lecture on fascinating research. Thank you so much, Dr. Srinivasan and ICTS. I'm going to pass this along to the American Foundry Society folks if they haven't already been watching. So thank you.
Oh, that's wonderful. Thank you, Dr. Scott, and hope to keep in touch. And it's great to hear from, expert in metallurgy like you. That is great for the morale. So thank you so much for your kind words.
So there are other messages of gratitude also from R. Vasudevan. So thanks again. Everybody is very happy to listen to you. And all the best, and stay safe, please.
Thank you. Thank you so much, and all the best. Bye-bye.